I'm certainly glad we had that song of preparation there, because coming right after Mike and a newborn would be a heck of a honor. So, really a great time to see a little one like that in church, and to know the future the church is in such good hands. Our New Testament lesson today is from the 25th chapter of the book of Matthew. They who have an ear to hear, let them hear the word of our Lord. For it is this man, going on a journey, summoned his slaves and entrusted his property to them. To one he gave 5 talents, to another 2, and to a third he gave 1 talent, to each according to his ability. And then he went away. The one who received the 5 talents went off at once and traded with them, and made 5 more talents. In the same way, the one who had the 2 talents made 2 more. But the one who had received the 1 talent went off and dug a hole in the ground and hid his master's money. After a long time, the master of those slaves came back and settled the accounts with them. Then the one who had received 5 talents came forward, bringing 5 more talents, saying, "Master, you handed over to me 5 talents. See, I have made 5 more. His master said to him, "Well done, good and trustworthy slave. You have been trustworthy in a few things. I will put you in charge of many things. Enter into the joy of your master." And the one who had received the 2 talents also came forward, saying, "Master, you handed over to me these 2 talents, and see, I have made 2 more. His master said to him, "Well done, good and trustworthy slave. You have been trustworthy with a few things. I will put you in charge of many things. Enter into the joy of your master." Then the one who had received the 1 talent also came forward, saying, "Master, I knew you were a harsh man, reaping where you do not sow, and gathering where you did not gather seed. So I was afraid, and I went out, and I hid your talent in the ground. Here you have what is yours." But his master replied, "You wicked and lazy servant, you knew, did you, that I reap where I do not sow, and gather where I do not scatter? Then you ought to have invested my money with the bankers, and on my return I would have at least received what was my own with some interest." So taking the talent from him, he gave it to the one with the 10 talents. For to those who have, more will be given, and they will have an abundance. But for those who have nothing, even what they have will be taken away. As for the worthless slave, throw him into the outer darkness, where there will be weeping and much gnashing of teeth. Word of the Lord. Thanks be to God. May God add his blessing to this, the reading and the study of his holy word. Amen.
Amen. Here we are again. In the midst of this sermon series on producing miracles, and in the midst of a few very troublesome parables, these stories of Jesus that we need to pare down and simplify, because otherwise we might hear Jesus doing or saying a few things that doesn't really sound like the Jesus that we know. We know that he's telling this story to this group of followers, and he's telling this story of the parable of the talents. He's telling a story about a landowner who's been absent, entrusted the land with the people, and then gone away for a really long time. Anyone remember how much got done the day a substitute teacher arrived? Right? Likewise, when the absentee landlord is a part of the picture or the story, you kind of wonder how responsible the children are being. But Jesus is telling this story about this landlord. And if we're not careful, we might hear Jesus affirming the institution of slavery, which I'm sure that he is not. But Jesus is telling the story with the people in signs of the times that they were living in. Our story might be told a bit differently from that. We also might hear, if we're not careful, Jesus validating or celebrating that one would be banished to the outer darkness, where there would be weeping and gnashing of teeth. And I don't know about you, but that's not really the Jesus that I know. But what's really, really interesting, that as we come to the end of what we call the liturgical year, right, we're getting ready to roll over and start with Advent, preparing for the birth, the coming again of Jesus. And so it is that the people who are banished into the outer darkness will see a great light. Upon them a light will shine. And so it is that in this season, as the end of the year rolls around, we've worked through the first half of the year, where we've read the stories of Jesus' life. And then the second half of the year, where we talk about Jesus' teachings. And then we come to the end, and we get these images of an absentee landlord. We get these images of a delay in the return of his coming. And what will his children do with his property in the meantime? And the parable says, the way Jesus tells it, is that each one was given according to their ability. Right? And some received 10 talents, and some 5, and some 1, and some were able to earn more and produce good fruit, and some could double their money, and the one slave was frightened. So he buried the one treasure because he didn't want to lose that one. And while the absentee landlord wasn't very happy with that, we might want to look back on Jesus. You know, we know that Jesus ate with sinners and tax collectors and touched the unclean, right? He was constantly breaking the rules of the society as they knew it. Breaking the rules in order to create a moment in time of healing, of nurture, of compassion. And this, there might be an element here of this too. Because what we don't always remember is that bearing interest was another code that Jesus seems to be arguing here. Collecting interest was against the rules of the society. And while we know that we don't want to read this parable literally, we do want to realize that we too are members of the vineyard, right? We are working in God's vineyard, entrusted with much, and are called to produce good fruit. Now, we know that we're in the midst of this sermon series. Hang on, I want to get to. We're in the midst of this sermon series where we've been talking about what it's going to take to make a miracle in our own lives. And we've talked about how we need clarity on where we have been. We need to have authenticity and be who we are. We need to have humility and know our limitations, and we need to be prepared, not for disaster, for a miracle. And this morning's text is reminding us that we need to be responsible with God, what God has given, with what God is doing in our lives. We are responsible. Responsibility, we are able to respond to God's people in God's world. And it's true that we're realizing that Jesus is telling us something about the delay in the return. But we live in a time when the landowner is fully present, not absent. We worship a Lord of the land who is fully present to us because he's born again. Year in and year out, we're given another opportunity to realize his inbreaking, and that we want to be good stewards of the gifts. We want to use wisely all that's been entrusted to us. And you know, this church itself is a good steward. We are using every inch of this building to do good ministries in the community. When another Girl Scout troop calls, we're finding another 3 rooms open downstairs during the week. When another group AA wants to create another meeting during the course of the week, we find another night where we can expand and open another classroom. And likewise, with Family Promise coming this week, we've got this opportunity to open our doors to 2 families at least, is it 3 families with 4, 5, 6 children and be there with them. We've been entrusted with the church, with each other, with the work that we're called to do, with the Sunday school, with the mission trip, with the music ministry, and we've been entrusted with the building. And we are constantly opening our doors. And we don't just want to bring a meal, you see. We don't want to just bring a meal or companionship. This church has a way of doing extravagant things for the people who feel like they might be walking in a time of outer darkness, where they might feel like they're being punished for something they haven't done right. How did I get here, right? A handful of bad decisions that any of us could be foreclosed upon, isn't it true? And so it is that this church wants to do things that are over and above, not just cook dinner, but provide a traveling zoo. On Friday, Mike Vrabel has set up to have a traveling zoo come to be on the property so that children who are in Family Promise won't feel like they're sleeping in the basement of the church, but that the church really cares about them. Not so much so that we're going to go the extra mile and bring in a traveling zoo. And I hope that if there are families of the church who are in town and you want to come over to affirm those children, will do that. And then on Friday night, maybe over the weekend, this sanctuary is transformed into a movie theater just for the kids who feel like they're walking in a time of darkness, getting ready to see a great light. They're going to get a glimpse of it here. We're going to open it for a movie night, maybe play some football over the weekend. You see, we don't want to just open our doors and just provide a bed. We want to provide for them the best. A zoo that'll come to them, because this time in their lives is a time when the light of Christ is going to shine for them. Because our landlord is not absent. Our landlord, the Lord of the land, is fully present. And this afternoon, you're going to get kicked out of coffee hour. You're going to have a little snack and have a cup of coffee, and yeah, some of you are going to come back and prepare for the cantata. But at 12 o'clock, strange people, not strange people, but people you don't know, are going to come into the building dropping off platters and platters of food. And 450 Thanksgiving dinners are going to be plated here in our building by the people who are involved in the farmer's market. They're going to come and they're going to plate, they're going to use our space. We were one of the few people who had enough food to let them in on a Sunday morning. You see, we've been entrusted with much. And sometimes we feel like we're not doing enough. But membership in a church like this one allows us to feel a part of not only a children's message and then they're off to Sunday school, but that we're going to open our doors when people need space to do the work of God, to feed God's people. Our doors are going to be open. Our doors are going to be open. Our hearts are going to be open that we might be full, that all God's children might be full. You know, I don't like this parable because I feel really sorry for that last slave who was frightened and didn't really have a job where he could dump all his money and was afraid to put it into the stock market, because we know how that goes, right? You know, he lost his IRA, his 401k, and he decided that at least he was going to protect what God has given him. And so when he buries that and then is scolded by the absentee landlord as a worthless slave, I cannot help but hear we are at the end of the liturgical year because Jesus is coming. The light that shines in the darkness is coming. The one who is found in those spaces on the edges, in that place where we banish people who are not good enough. That's where Jesus is found. In this church, through this week, with these people who we're going to make holiday for, not me, I'm going to be seeing you with my family, but the people of this congregation are going to have Thanksgiving with people who have nowhere to go. That's the work of the church. The only thing that I can say about that slave is he wasn't yet ready for the miracle. But that doesn't mean the miracle's not coming. Don't leave before the miracle happens. Trust. Be clear about where you are so that you can be authentic in who you are. Be humble and know your limitations and then get ready, not for disaster, but for a miracle to happen. Claim your responsibility with all that you've been given. And then get ready, because the light is coming. Amen.